You're listening to Prosperity Report, Love and Money Podcast. I'm your host, Kene Corder, best-selling author, international speaker, and clinical hypnotherapist specializing in financial therapy. Each week, we'll bring you actionable ideas, tips, tools, and resources to help you get the mindset shift you need to feel more confident personally and financially so you can reduce stress, work less, and make a huge impact on your world and your income. Now, let's get into today's show. Do you ever wonder if your brain is secretly plotting against you? The truth is, it is. Your brain is full of negative messages and programs. These negative messages block you from success and cause stress. And right now, whether you know it or not, your brain is standing in the way of your success, the success you were meant to have. Over my years of clinical practice, I've created a system that helps uncover the counterproductive brain habits imprinted by society. If your business has not reached the level of success you would like it to, it's time to take action. Join me and one powerful group of achievers in my free coaching community. It's the tribe for people who want to get guidance and connection so they can be in business for themselves, but not by themselves. Go to kenecorder.com/community. Get the guidance and connection you need to take your business to the next level. Go to kenecorder.com/community. Hey there, guys. Welcome to the show. Guess what we're going to talk about today? Moving towards your dreams. And I chose moving towards your dreams because our guest today is a dancer, and she talks all about how to get in touch with your body, but get in touch with your self through movement, and how you can become your true authentic self by really touching that gut inside of you. And the way you touch your gut is to get in touch with your body. And the way you get in touch with your body is to move your body. So she's going to tell us all about it. And at the end, she and I are going to give you a special little gift, a gift to help you move towards your dreams. So listen all the way to the end so you can get that little freebie. In the meantime, let me introduce today's guest. Brielle Friedman is a professional dancer, writer, and marketing consultant based in New York City. After falling in love with salsa dancing during a study abroad experience in Guatemala, Brielle began training in Latin dance and won her first professional competition just 5 years later. A true believer in the power of dance and movement, she created Go Deeper, a different kind of dance class for greater confidence, connection, and intimacy. When she's not teaching and performing, Brielle helps entrepreneurs and creatives build innovative brand and marketing strategies through her creative studio, BF Creative. Her approach is simple: to share what you do in the most real, most powerful, and most beautiful way possible so you can genuinely connect faster. These are all things we teach here at Presidential Lifestyle and on Prosperity Report. So keep your ears open for a handful of really good marketing tools, but also ways to move toward your dream. So guys, please join me in welcoming our guest today, Brielle. Hey, Brielle.
Hey, Kene, how are you?
I am awesome. I'm so glad you're here. It's been like a long time coming.
Yeah, it really has. I'm very glad to be here. Thank you so much for having me.
Yes. So there's a question that I ask every guest. What is your idea of prosperity?
Yeah, and I think it's such a great question. To me, I think ultimate prosperity means being in a state of total freedom where you can express your desires, where you can move, you can act, speak in a way that's 100% uninhibited, and when you're not holding anything back. And so for me, that is very connected to feeling safe and feeling secure, whether it's career-wise, whether it's financially, which I know you talk a lot about, whether it's like in relationships, in your body, but you're not making decisions from a place of fear or I should do this or I need to do this because of X, but because of desire, and you really have that ultimate self-trust.
Yeah. I love how you said uninhibited. And I also love how you said it shouldn't be those shoulds, you know, well, I should do this kind of like because society told you to,
yes. You
know, and that's the programming.
Yes.
Yeah, that is so cool. That is a really good idea of prosperity. Because what I find is that it's different things to different people, which is why I asked that question, because I just love hearing everybody's different answers.
Yeah, it is so different for everyone. That for me, especially in pursuing dance, that idea of, oh, I shouldn't do this because society is telling me it's going to be hard, was such a big thing for me to move through and overcome. Everyone does have such a different definition of prosperity, of success, of happiness. And so there's really no one size fits all. And I think that that is what, you know, this journey of life, especially for me in my 20s, was so much about, like, figuring out what my mind looks like and then how do I create that and being okay with the fact that it's going to require making very different choices from so many people around me. And that can be really hard.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. I just got chills when you said that, because you said making different choices than the people around me. And a lot of times that's when we get too scared to do what's in our heads, what's in our brains, and even our guts, because nobody else is doing it. And so we're like, no, I want to stay connected to the tribe. I'll just do what everybody else is doing, even though they're not happy either.
Yeah. Yeah. That was a huge thing for me, for sure. You know, I did start dancing after college. It's when I started training in salsa and Latin dance. And it felt really late to start, you know, doing this whole new thing. And so many dancers around me had been in ballet and in jazz and grown up at studio and had been dancing since they were 5, 6. And I remember I was living in San Francisco at the time, and I was working in a very small office with other young 20-something-year-olds, and they were all becoming friends, you know? And so after work, they'd grab drinks, they'd hang out on the weekends, they'd go to shows. And at first they would ask me to come along, and I, you know, politely declined because I had dance, I had rehearsal, and I needed to go to the studio and practice. I wasn't actually really good at dancing yet. So it was really hard. There was this period where, you know, we were out of college and I sort of saw everyone around me moving on this other path. And I was very determinedly going towards mine. And I wanted to say no to these things so I could dance. But I also wasn't really sure if I was ever going to gain the physical and like technical ability to do dance in the way that I wanted. And that was very challenging. I say it was this like very lonely period of my time, even though I was pretty much surrounded by people, you know, 24/7. It was hard.
Yeah. And it's so funny that you say that. I can't even imagine you not being good at it, because you're so good at it. Guys, you've got to find her on Instagram and look at some of her videos. Like, she is an amazing dancer. Just imagining you not good at it yet, I'm like, I thought you were born dancing.
Thank you. Thank you so much. When I teach, I always say, you know, I haven't really been doing this for that long, and I started from no experience. So if I can learn to dance, I really believe that everyone can learn. It's like anything in life. The more you practice, the more you see your body change, the more you see your abilities change.
Yeah, it's so true. I cannot wait to come to New York City. Yay. And dance with you. So guys, I do want to tell you how we met, because I feel like that's just a fun part of the story. And Brielle, correct me where I go off, because I believe we met. I was on a podcast, and I think it was Stacking Benjamin's podcast. And you might have reached out to me, maybe on Instagram. We connected there, and I think you like complimented me, and we really had that connection that you talked about that I mentioned in your bio. We had that connection, and we stayed connected, and we chatted back and forth on Instagram. And then I guess our relationship got deeper, and because I watched you and I see what you do, and I have this show, and it's all about finding your purpose and your passion and pursuing it and doing what brings you closer to your idea of prosperity. I was like, wow, I think I should have Brielle on the show. And it just hit me. And so I reached out to you and you're like, yeah, I'll do it.
Yeah, no, that's the story. And it was such a wonderful connection. And I remember hearing you on the podcast. And at that time I was, you know, I knew that I wanted to leave my full-time corporate job. And I was really trying to learn a lot more about money and my relationship with money. I had a lot of anxiety around it. And so I was reading all these blogs, listening to all these podcasts. And I remember you talking about how partners can have different ideas of what financial prosperity means to them. You know, some people feel really prosperous when they're saving money. Some people feel really prosperous when they're making, they have money coming in, and how that can bring about a lot of tension. And it was just, I remember I was listening to it in the subway and it was such this aha moment of, I never even thought about that. I didn't even have a structure or a way to relate that. And so, yeah, it was really powerful. I loved the way that you approach financial health and financial wellness. And I reached out to you afterwards on Instagram and started following you and have just seen, you know, everything that you do is so aligned in your life. And I think that's really cool. And that's something that I've been working so hard to create for myself in the past 18 months that it was this beautiful, you know, meeting.
Yes. And you don't know it, but that's like the biggest compliment, like to tell me that I'm aligned, like to say, okay, yeah, you're living, you practice what you preach. Like, oh, yes, yeah. That's what I live for. I really do live to practice what I preach because I think in life we get distracted. And even though the words that come out of our mouth, we know what to do, but we're not always doing it. So yes, thank you. Thank you for saying that.
Yeah, no, you're welcome.
And I'm glad you reached out because had you not done that, that's pretty a powerful step to take. And that was like a year ago, maybe.
Yeah, I'm glad I reached out to you too. I think that that's something I wouldn't have done, you know, earlier in my life. I would have just, you know, been like, okay, nice podcast. And it kept going. But, you know, something I've learned to do too is just to reach out to make a connection and just to express gratitude to someone and to go there. And I'm so glad that I did.
Wow. And so what you just did was practice what you preach.
Yes. And like you said, you know, that is always the biggest compliment for me too, is because it's really hard. It's hard to practice what you preach. And it's a practice. It requires waking up every day and recommitting to yourself and who you are and what you want. And I think we move about throughout our day. And especially, you know, I live in New York City and New York City is nuts sometimes. So I walk out of my apartment, there are so many external forces that are just slowly, maybe subconsciously kind of pulling me away from that center. Mm-hmm. And I really do work so hard to come back to that center. And some days I do a really great job. And other days I go to sleep. I'm like, okay, tomorrow's a new time to restart. But
yeah, let's just do that over.
Yeah, exactly.
So one of the things I just heard you say a few minutes ago was that you were listening to podcasts and you were reading blogs and all of that, doing some research because you were knowing or thinking that you were going to leave your corporate job. And so I want to go in that direction because this episode is really all about preparing for that step. But then there's also some stuff we're going to talk about that you can't even prepare for, right?
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
So you were listening to podcasts because you were kind of planning this move out of corporate. And I think you had some idea of where you were going, but not 100% sure. Tell me about that.
Yeah. So I got to a place where I could tell I was pretty unhappy in my role. And that was really challenging for me because I had worked at this particular company for a very long time. And I loved my boss. I always say that if you have a good relationship with your manager, that's the number one thing that keeps employees or eventually they leave. So I had this amazing boss who became a really good friend. I was managing a team, like a full marketing team, and they were incredible, incredible people. And I have loved this role for such a long time. I'd been at the company for about 6 years, which is a really long time, especially I think today in the way that we work.
Yes, for a millennial.
Yes, for a millennial. It was like, it was unheard of. And I had loved it. It was such a big part of my identity. And I did do about 6 to 8 months of leadership coaching, which was a lot of life coaching. And through that experience, I really recognized that there were all these limiting beliefs that I had that I didn't even know I had. And as I was moving through them, it became apparent to me that I needed to make a change and I needed to let go of this professional experience and move into the next chapter of my journey.
Wow.
Yeah. And I didn't know what that next step was going to be. So I knew I'd been at this company for a long time. I wanted to take, you know, quote unquote, a couple of months off. And that's when I remember one day I kind of looked in the mirror and said, okay, you really need to figure out your finances. And it wasn't that I didn't know anything about my finances, but I didn't really have a super tight sense on how much I was spending every month or how much savings I had to have if I wanted to have 3 months of not working so that I could, you know, continue mm-hmm. this journey. So that's when I started listening to the podcast and blogs. And I was really looking for what is this magic number of how much money you should have set aside before you leave a corporate full-time role. And I was trying to find someone who had that number of what does that look like? And there is no magic number.
Right. Yeah, I was laughing about that. I'm like, looking for that? That's forever search.
Yeah. Exactly. It doesn't exist. So I had to mm-hmm. create what was mine. You know, then I started just tracking what I was spending a lot more closely and figuring out where I could let go of some expenses. What are the things that were most important to me before I made that leap? By the time I left, I had probably about $14,000, $15,000 like in my bank account in savings. And that number really didn't feel even that secure to me, especially mm-hmm. living in New York. I felt very grateful because I'm in an apartment where my rent is relatively inexpensive, again, for New York. But that number wasn't going to last me months and months and months. But it also just got to that point where I felt like I had to do this. Like I just had to leave. And I knew I would figure it out. And then I like put the trust in myself to be like, you have to do this for yourself. You have to open up space. You know, this is the right choice. And eventually I, you know, left.
I want to really drill down into that a little bit more, because what I heard you say was that you weren't 100% sure that you had it all planned out, but you were 100% sure that you needed to do it right now. Like, this is the time.
Exactly. Yeah.
And so there's a conflict there. Like, your brain is saying, wait, hold on, we still got more to do. And your heart or your gut is saying, go now.
Yeah.
Go jump.
Yeah.
So did you have any techniques or tools that you used to quiet your brain and just listen to your gut?
For sure. So that's where I go back to dance a lot, where, you know, one of the amazing things that dance has brought me is this connection with my body. And growing up, even in college, that wasn't something I really had. I don't think it's something we talk about or really teach that much, especially in a more Western culture. Yeah. So, you know, when I'm able to dance, I kind of and totally turn my brain off, these things will come up for me. And then with practice, I've learned to turn my brain off and then listen to them, even when I come out of that experience.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. That gave me chills because I know exactly what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's so powerful. And I'm really grateful that I've been able to do that. I wake up in the morning, and mornings are very sacred to me. So I always get up and I make a pour over coffee, and that experience is very grounding to me. And I write in my journal for a few minutes and I try to spend a little bit of time outside. I also really believe in reading novels and reading stories, because I get pulled into that story so much that whatever I feel anxious about, I don't even have the ability to feel anxious about anymore, because I'm no longer in my story. I'm in someone else's. And that can be really calming.
Because it's like, it's kind of like watching a movie, but you create the movie in your brain as you're reading the story.
Yes. Yes, exactly. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, when I stop reading and I come back into whatever experience I'm in, or I'm about to start my day, I just feel more grounded and I feel less like nothing that I do today is going to alter the rest of my life forever. And it's everything can be changed. And so I think that that's helpful as well.
That is.
Yeah. You had said that, you know, part of it was planned and part of it was unplanned. And mm-hmm, the part that was unplanned is that I really thought after I took these 3 months off, I was going to get another corporate job come the beginning of the year, the beginning of 2019. And the really surprising part for me was that when I made this change, it was very scary to not have a steady paycheck coming in for the first time ever as an adult. I started working in college and then right after I graduated. But as soon as I made that space and listened to my body, all of these other opportunities opened up for me. And that's something that I couldn't have planned for. You know, someone reached out to me and asked me if I could do some consulting work for them on the marketing side of things. And someone asked me to teach some dance classes. And then I started teaching dance and I was like, oh, I really love teaching. I didn't know that. I'd never given myself permission to love or want to teach dance because I had this block that, oh, I started too late, so I can't be a dance teacher. Or like, I have more dancing growth to do, so I can't possibly share what I've learned, you know, in my own journey now, which I really had to continue to let go of those limiting beliefs. So, you know, now what I'm doing, it's been about a year, is just, I couldn't have planned for the moment that I am in right now.
So I'm glad you said that. And that still adds to what I was just about to say. Two things that I want to talk about. One is you have, sounds like two passions. You know, dance is a passion. Marketing is another passion. They both have their income streams. So they're two different income streams, but they're fulfilling areas in your body or your life. And so how do you kind of balance those two passions that you have?
Yeah. And that's also a great question. It's taken me a very long time to come to a place where I can have both and I allow myself to have both. And I think, you know, when I first started dancing, there were a lot of people in my life who had very good intentions and really were trying to give me very good advice and said things to me like, dancing is very hard to make money dancing, or like, you're never going to make money dancing.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. No, but can I, even last night I had a show, and at the end of the show, it was a great event. It was a beautiful venue. We were talking. And even then, someone came up in the audience and they complimented our show and then said to me, yeah, you know, you've really chosen a difficult profession. And I know that now I've done enough, you know, internal emotional work to know that that comes from their own fear.
Their own fear. Yep.
Mm-hmm. And I can let go of that and just sort of laugh at it and continue on.
Yeah. Cause I've taken dance classes and it was a big chunk out of my budget.
Yes, it's true.
My dance instructor does not play. He's like, I want my money.
Yeah. Yeah. And I also feel like you can create a business doing anything.
Yes.
If you have a service to offer, if you have a product to offer, if you have value that you are bringing to someone, and I truly believe that dance brings so much value, whether you're pursuing it just for fun or you're pursuing it for a different reason, it does so much. It brings us so much joy. It brings us so much good. It helps us feel more confident. So if I'm offering that to someone as teaching them dance, like, sure, I can make money doing that because that's like offering someone, you know, anything else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, exactly. You're offering them value because just like in my dance class, I think what I got out of it so much because I went into it confidence and I have been dancing since I was a kid. But what I got from Antonio and Mario was this sense of fun that I wasn't having because I was working so much. And like, it was just across the street from my office. So it made it super easy for me to go after work or on my lunch to go to a dance class. And I did private. I could schedule it anytime mm-hmm. I needed to, but it was like my sense of fun outside of work. And then we preparing for a show, there was that more of that connection. And here's my little secret. I never give my full performance during rehearsal. Yeah. So by the time we got to the performance, I was really connected with my fellow dancers who they were all seemed like they probably were better than me. And they had been all practicing longer than I had. I came in a little late to this particular dance studio. And then I like broke out in like full out dance. And they were like, what the hell just happened?
That's amazing.
So that was a lot of fun too. Just like blowing their minds. And even my friends in the audience, cause it was like a couple years after I moved to Atlanta. So I had friends, but there was so much that they didn't mm-hmm. know about me because there's like these layers to me. And so they're like, wait, I did not know you could dance like that. I was like, so it was kind of fun, like just breaking out in my little kitten showing up.
Yeah, that's wonderful. That's so cool.
And that's what you give people, that you tap into that. I talked about that when I introduced you, you know, that movement, that confidence, the connection with other people, but the connection with your body and that sense of fun, because dance is just so much fun.
It is.
Even when you're not good at it.
Yeah, if you are having fun, if you enjoy and like love what you're doing, everyone else around you, when you're in that state, you just light up. You light up yourself. You light up the energy around you. And that's what people gravitate to, you know, like you just being so into whatever it is you're doing. And that was also something that was really hard for me to learn and really believe in the beginning of my dance journey, because I always wanted to be a professional dancer, and I always wanted to be where I am now. And I just wasn't sure it was going to happen. And so I really struggled with the journey, you know, and appreciating the ride. And it was only until I was really able to say to myself, you know what, like, it doesn't matter. Like, no one cares. And all that matters is that I'm loving what I'm doing right now. And I think that when you can just have fun and go into your body and just love your own movement, then that is what, you know, makes a really great performance. That's what grabs someone's attention. And that's what helps with connection too. So that's amazing that you're able to have that experience. And
yeah, it was so much fun. Now, I know I hear my audience. When people are talking, I can hear my audience questions in my head. So they're probably saying, how? They just want to know how. How did you enjoy the process? Because you said there were times when you didn't know if it was going to happen. How do you keep going through that?
Yeah, again, such a good question. I think that when we have a really deep desire, we have something we feel really strongly, have a very deep passion for something, there is that like very thing deep inside of you that just makes you keep going. And sometimes, you know, I mean, I was working full time at one time, I was dancing on two teams, I had a partner routine, I was like, it was very stressful. And it was just so nuts, sort of looking back on it, that there were moments where I was just like, oh my God, like, what are you doing? Like, what are you doing? But there was this thing that just didn't let me quit, that literally said, just keep going. With dance, what is really nice is that because it is visual, you can see your progress. So watching videos is always really helpful. I think in professional environments where you're writing, that can be the similar thing. I think that's why it's so important to, you know, set your objectives every quarter, every year, whether it's working for a company, working for yourself, because that progress does really fuel you in those moments you feel like giving up. It's like that one little glimmer of hope that you need. So every time I sort of thought about, okay, maybe it's time to stop doing this. And it's not like that thought never came up. You know, this voice would come and just be like, just keep going, like just keep going. And I will say I had built a very strong support group around me. So I have an amazing coach and I feel very grateful I found her in the very beginning of my dance journey. And she was really the first person who I felt comfortable expressing to her, like, you know, I want to dance professionally. I want to be a competitive dancer. And I felt like she took me seriously. Other people I had come across, I didn't feel that way. So, you know, having her support has been really helpful. And I think that that's really important to build as well when you have a big dream, when you have a big goal. Surround yourself with people who believe in you and will nicely but strongly remind you why you want what you want in those moments you feel like you want to give up.
Yes. That's a big part of what we teach in our program, you know, that team, that support system, that tribe, because the reason why I started Prosperity Club is mainly because I know that I felt alone, like I felt isolated sometimes. And because like you, I have more than one passion. And like a lot of my listeners, when you are multi-talented, even if you start out bad at something, and you have like multi-passions, it can become confusing. And so that's the other part of it. So there was an isolation, there's that confusion, but then you see you have this tribe and you're like, oh, There's Brielle, who also has multi-passions. She's just like me, because I meet a lot of people who have like one passion and they go after it. Like, you know, some people grow up saying, I'm going to be a doctor, or I'm going to be a hairstylist, or I'm going to be, and they do that, and they do it for 50 years or whatever.
Yeah.
I just didn't have that. That wasn't me.
Yeah, same. And it's been very hard for me too, to see someone with one clear, like very straightforward passion and go for it, where I feel I love dancing and I love marketing and I love writing. And those have felt so different to me at certain times. And it was only when I, yeah, saw other people's stories. And you were a really great example of that, Kinney, of someone who was passionate about lots of things and had built this life where you're able to have them all and weave them together. And a light bulb went off and it was like, oh, okay. Like, yeah, I can do that too. And then through that, I found that these three things that I love and I keep getting called back to, they're all storytelling in some way. They're all bringing to life different stories, and they're all about connection and connecting with other human beings. And that's another question I love, which is this question, what makes your heart sing? You know, I will often journal about that question. And for me, it always comes down to the connection we feel with other people. Like, as a human, I feel like that is so intrinsic to being a human, is that we're able to connect. And dance allows me to do that. You know, marketing allows me to do that. Writing allows me to do that. For me, that has been really helpful, to see it as this one larger thing where these passions feed into it. It was only then that I was able to feel like I didn't have to choose, and, you know, to wrap them all into one.
Nice. Yeah. So that brings me to marketing. I want to dive a little bit deeper into that, because a lot of my listeners are creative entrepreneurs, and I know that's who you work closely with. But for creatives, sometimes marketing can be difficult, because although marketing is creative, it has a very like step-by-step kind of feel to it. And so you can get lost if you don't do all 17 steps that go into marketing. How do you help somebody like build their brand and create that marketing image that they're looking for?
So it's true, because I do work with a lot of creatives. And while marketing is very creative, I always say it's structured creativity. It is very structured. And so what I really focus on is, okay, what is the big picture? What are your long-term goals? What are you trying to create? And then I work to break that down and make it into a step-by-step plan that will get you, or get your company, to that end goal. I often find that in the middle is where people kind of get a little lost, or the messaging, what you're actually saying, what is the value you actually bring, that gets a bit jumbled in the middle. And so oftentimes I work with entrepreneurs and business owners to clean that part up and get us back on track to this ultimate vision. And what I'll say is, you know, as a dancer, I have a dance coach. I also work with a business coach. As a writer, I always have an editor. As good as you are at doing whatever it is, you always need an outside perspective to help you. You really do. And yeah. I know that you believe this so much, and it's something that you practice and preach, because it's very hard. You get in the thick of it and it becomes harder and harder to look at the big picture and be like, okay, does this thing that I'm doing right now, this thing that I'm spending time and money on, why am I doing it? And does it actually help me accomplish my end goal, which is to bring in new clients, or to build my business, or to launch this new product, or to offer this new service? And when you have no one else to work with on that, you're just like in this black box by yourself. And that's very, very hard.
Yeah, it is. And like, as we speak, we're in the middle of a launch. And on the way to this launch, there was a lot of confusion that would get in. One, because I practice and I preach like honing in on your target market. But my target market, I was getting tighter and tighter and niching down even more. So that meant my message had to niche down and get even tighter. Some places it was, and other places it wasn't. So it's like really looking at all the different places where my message was out there and shifting it. And I would keep finding places where like, oh, I didn't change it here or I didn't change it there. And that was frustrating to the point where I was like, why am I doing this on my own? I need a marketing assistant. Like, somebody's got to help me do this. I can't do all of this and run the company. So I appreciate what you said about having another person in there, because a lot of times, especially as entrepreneurs or solopreneurs, we hang our hats on this idea that we've got to do everything in the business. And it's just not true. Hiring somebody like you can really free up the creativity to do the other things in the business.
Right. And the things that you love, and probably the reason why you wanted to start your business in the first place, especially in today's very interconnected digital social media driven world, I often work with a lot of solo entrepreneurs who feel a ton of pressure to, like, okay, I have to do Facebook and do Pinterest and do Twitter and do this and have a podcast and do a video series and blog. And it's like, no, like, one, you can't do all those things. And two, you don't. You should focus on where it is that your target market shows up. Where do they go for information? And where do they go for information about the product or service that you offer? And a lot of times I find that there's misalignment. Maybe, you know, someone is devoting a ton of time into Instagram because they are targeting bloggers, and fashion bloggers do spend a lot of time on Instagram. But are they looking for marketing tools on Instagram? Maybe, maybe not. And those are the types of questions that I really work through with my clients. You know, who is your target audience? Which, it's really awesome to hear you got more and more and more specific about that, because I do just like a free consult call to make sure working together is a good fit. And I'll always ask, who's your target market? And it's always way too broad. It's like, well, women who are 18 to 55 who live all over the United States. And that's too big. Like, what? Like,
yeah. Or they're like, oh, I can help everybody. Like, I'm not asking you if your product is good for everybody. I'm asking you, who do you love or enjoy working with? And where do you want to spend your marketing dollars?
Yeah, yeah. So just drilling in on those questions, you know, reveal a lot and can really help us prioritize, because you can't do it all. And I definitely don't believe in, you know, you created a business to do what you love and also to create the entire life that you want. So if you're spending 120 hours a week working on your business, you're going to be very miserable. And then this amazing thing that you love doing, that you create this company about, is not even going to help the people you want to help because you are so miserable. So we really look at, yeah, who are you trying to reach and why are you investing in these marketing initiatives? What does it help you accomplish? And, you know, for larger companies too, I see a lot of misalignment between what the sales team is doing, what the marketing team is doing, what the product team is doing, what the client success team is doing, and getting that alignment. You know, we talked about in the beginning how that's so important to your life as a person. That's so important to your business. And that's also what I will look at, you know, whether, yeah, you're doing everything on your own or you're a team of hundreds of people. You really always have to go back to the alignment.
Yes, that is so good. So we are coming to the end of our interview. So I have one more question for you. So typically I try to, like, narrow this question to what it is you do. And the question is, what is the best marketing advice you've ever received? Or maybe what is the best dance advice you ever received? Whichever one you want to go with.
Yeah. The best advice that I think applies to both of those things is do what feels right to you, and then you will attract the people you're trying to attract for your business or your product. You will also, you know, in terms of movement, if you do what you love when you're dancing, you will attract the people who love what you do. And I think that that is where we have prosperity in those moments. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So do what feels right for you, even if it's different from what other people are doing.
Yes, that's so good. When you follow your gut, like when you do what's right for you, and usually what's right for you is what your gut says, you're going to end up in the right place with the right people, and it's going to feel really good. When it doesn't feel good is when you're not being your true authentic self. And so you never follow your gut. You follow whatever your head is saying, and then you're not around the right people because you're not being yourself. and they don't know you and you don't know them. And it just all is not aligned. So it feels off.
Yeah. And that's something especially in partnering, in partner dance, my dance coach will always say to me and my dance partner, like, it should feel comfortable. If it doesn't feel comfortable, something is wrong. And that's always what I feel like. You know, if I go out on a date and I don't feel comfortable, I don't feel like I'm showing up as my true self and I'm trying to show off or I feel nervous. It's like, what is about this person and their energy or this environment that is making me feel that way? What am I bringing to it? And what are they giving me, right? Because everything is an energy exchange. And that's something that, you know, I think dance helps us practice, because society does tell us in a lot of ways, you know, don't listen to your gut, don't listen to your body. And when something feels uncomfortable, there's a reason why it feels uncomfortable. Listen to that and act accordingly.
Yes. Cool. Well, this was way too fast. Like, we needed way more time. So we're going to have to do something else together. I just know we will. So you'll have to commit. You don't have a choice. You're doing something with me.
Yes. No, I'm so excited. It went by so quickly. I really can't believe we've been talking for. Thank you so much. Thank you.
So guys, I want you to go to kinecorder.com/Brielle, because if you want to hang out with her, she's going to tell you exactly where to meet her. But I'm going to make a special link just for you guys to hook up with her, and maybe we'll have something special for you. So you're going to go to kinecorder.com/Brielle, Brielle. It'll be in the show notes, so don't worry. And we'll have something special for you guys. But before we go, Brielle, where would you like them to connect with you if they need marketing, even if they just want to ask you a question and say, how did you go ahead and start doing dance? I've always wanted to dance, or I need to get something done with my marketing. Can you help me? How do they reach out to you?
Yes. The best way to reach me is on Instagram, and I share dance tips. I share marketing tips, branding tips. So it's at Brielle Friedman, BRIELLEFRIEDMAN. You can also go to my website, briellefriedman.com. I write a monthly newsletter, and you can sign up at my website, and you can email me, hello@briellefriedman.com. And if you are in New York or you're coming to New York, please reach out to me. We have Go Deeper classes that are happening once a month, and they're all about using dance for greater confidence, connection, intimacy. They're really powerful. And we are at Go Deeper Dance on Instagram.
Awesome. And that's cool, because New York is our third largest listenership. Believe it or not, where I'm from, Chicago is actually our biggest followers. It's kind of cool, like, that my hometown is where I have the most listeners. But
that is cool. That's awesome.
New York is one of my favorite cities, although I cannot live there, but I do like to visit.
Well, when you visit, we're going to dance.
We are.
I'm very excited for
me
that.
Too.
Yeah.
All right, guys. Well, hang out with Brielle, hang out with me, and come back here next week. Oh, we got to have some good stuff for you. All right. I'll see you guys sooner. Hey guys, thanks for listening all the way to the end. I'm so happy we had this show, and I really want to encourage you to move towards your dreams if you're not already. We talked about it last week and a couple weeks ago, just why dreams are so very important, but also thinking about what's not on your resume and why it's not there, because maybe you're not moving towards it. If you took anything away from today's episode, I'll encourage you to take away this idea that you stop listening to your head. Your head is probably trying to stop you from moving towards your goals, your dreams. I want you to stop listening to your head, your brain, and start listening to your gut. Move your body, get in touch with your gut, and listen to those positive messages that your gut is telling you, because it's really going to build you up for success. Listen to your gut. And like Brielle said, when you create that space, when you move all those distractions out the way, then things just show up for you. New opportunities, things that you wouldn't even been able to plan for. So that's our show for today. I just wanted to give you that little wrap up. And don't forget, go to kinecorder.com/Brielle for our little freebie for you. I'll see you guys sooner. Hey guys, thanks for listening. If you want more love and money conversations, subscribe to this podcast. Also, tell your friends about us. I'll see you next episode. But in the meantime, head on over to kinaquarter.com for more tips, tools, and resources. And go ahead and leave us a comment if you like. We'd love to hear from you. This show is not to replace professional counsel. The best advice comes from a professional you know. The topics discussed in this podcast are general in nature and are for entertainment and informational purposes only. We encourage you to meet with a professional to discuss your specific situation, whether financial or therapeutic. That's all for now. I'll see you sooner. Remember, no matter what anybody ever tells you, you can have wealth in all of its forms. Believe it, and you will soon see it.